So we will mostly be talking about Honeybadger and its integration to Open Ethereum and the Artist blockchain. So let's get started. Open Ethereum, we had a talk about it earlier today, so I won't go deeper into it. Just the things that we care about. And what we care about is that it's a fast and feature-rich multi-network. That's the thing that interests me. Ethereum client. That it got a pluggable consensus engine, which means you can start it with a variety of consensus engines. It comes with a couple out of the box, like Aura and Qlik, and of course the proof of work one. But it can be extended with new ones. And that's what we will exploring later in this talk. Then it's implemented in Rust, which is nice because I love Rust. And it's built for mission critical use. It's really one of the backbones of the Ethereum network. It's formally, I mean, that might be news for some people. It was formally called Parity, only has recently has become Open Ethereum, has been renamed in Open Ethereum because Parity technology is handed over to an open consortium. The Artist blockchain is an open permissionless smart contract platform, fully compliant with Ethereum, based on Open Ethereum, actually. Then it's an energy efficient Ethereum compliant blockchain, which with the added benefit of scalability, low fees, real-time transactions and ease deployment. And it's being deployed for zero carbon society for applications in the energy sector. And the third component is Honeybadger BFT. What is it? It's a paper that was published in 2016 by Andrew Miller, Yuxia, Kyle Roman, Elaine Shi, and Don Song, all from pretty renowned universities. So it's a really high quality paper. And the authors are obviously pretty proud of it. It's not often that you read in a scientific paper that things like the first practical asynchronous BFT protocol. So they didn't seem to be pretty sure about themselves there. It's designed to be highly robust, Byzantine fault tolerant for mission critical applications. So actually built for financial applications. Guarantees liveness without any timing assumptions. That's basically a feature of the asynchronous nature. And they did call it Honeybadger for a reason. They made it so robust that it even works over the Tor network. That's a network where latencies vary widely, and normally that's poison for consensus algorithms. But Honeybadger works even there. So let's go over the key features again. It's asynchronous, it's leaderless, it has got instant finality, it's censorship resistant, and because it's censorship resistant, it's also straightforward to implement a random beacon on the chain. So let's look about what's let's work out what the difference is to synchronous consensus protocols. Synchronous post-consensus protocols typically select a leader. So there's one node which then decides which transactions are getting included into the block. In a Byzantine setting, of course, you can never guarantee that this leader isn't himself a traitor or faulty, or however we want to call it. Which means you need a sort of a timeout, some way to make the chain continue, even if the currently selected leader is Byzantine. And that typically restricts the network to a fixed frequency of blocks or something equivalent. You could see proof of work also as a sort of consensus algorithm, where in principle there's no fixed frequency, but in practice there is. It's just built up that way. Then what does it mean to have a leaderless consensus? It means that every validator proposes a fraction of the transactions. So there's not one validator, one leader who proposes a block. It's all the validators in together form that one block by contributing only a part of the transactions which should be included. The way this works is they use threshold encryption to hide the content of the proposal and finalize the block in the moment when the encryption threshold is reached. So as soon as there are enough contributions to be just at the threshold where the content can be decrypted, the block is finalized, which means that every validator actually has to agree to something that he hasn't seen yet. And that's why he can't possibly censor it as well, because he only sees it when he has to upfront say that's this one which we include, and only after that he can actually read it and decrypt the transactions and build the block. And with the same mechanism, you can also introduce a random beacon. So every one of the validators can send a random number, and nobody can pre-select it or calculate the random number before the block is actually finalized. It also means that all validators contributing to a block author the block at the same time. That's also something that's very, very uncommon. Which means the block doesn't have an author. The block is the author is just set to zero in our case. So I drew a little diagram to visualize what's happening there. So we've got a network of four validator nodes. Each sends an encrypted contribution, and in this case, because in the Honeybadger BFT algorithm, we have the requirement that we have to have 3F plus one nodes for F 40 nodes. One of the four can be 40, which means threshold encryption is set at three, which means the fastest three actually are the ones which then form the block. It's not like in this diagram, it's a little bit wrong here, but only the three fastest will actually then form the block, decrypt the transactions, and do of course deduplication, because nobody knows what's in the contribution. Some may send the same transaction as the others. Some maybe not no transaction at all. So it's there's a step before building the actual block. You have to deduplicate and verify, and these which these two steps will then form the block. That of course has to be the same for all nodes, because as I said before, the block will be generated at the same time on all these nodes. Slightly different view, a slightly more detailed view. Every one of the validators has got a local transaction queue. He selects transactions for contribution. The paper suggests that you take the maximum amount of transactions which can be in a block, divided by the number of validators, and then randomly select from those. That prevents from everybody sending the same transactions, for example, which wouldn't be efficient. So you keep the overlaps between the transactions in the contributions to a minimum. Then, of course, these transactions which you selected are encrypted, then broadcast to the others. Then there's a binary agreement step. Then you decrypt when the threshold is reached. Deduplicate and verify, and you wind up with a finalized list of transactions, which is the same for everybody, for all the validators. Let's already talked about the random beacon, but let's repeat the concept quickly. All validator nodes contribute a random number. The random numbers of all validators contributing to a block will be XORed. And that, of course, can only happen after the threshold has been reached and the block is final, which means no validator can calculate the random number before it is finalized. And then for example, via a system call, the final number can be made available through a simple contract on the chain to other contracts. Then, that's a one interesting topic. How do blocks actually get created? Who triggers the creation of blocks? Because remember, there are no timing parameters. So without any trigger, it wouldn't create any blocks. There's really only one mandatory trigger defined. When more than one third of other validators when you received the contributions of more than one third of one third or more of other validators, then you must join. So even if you don't have any transactions on the queue, then you just have to send an empty contribution. But every correct node has to contribute if one third of the other validators have sent a contribution to him. Of course, if nobody ever sends anything, then this would never be a valid assumption. So you have to have some other trigger which starts a block. And the most obvious one is if a transaction is on the transaction queue, then start creating a block. Just start sending, start the Honey Badger epoch and send your contribution. And because, of course, all the validators are also gossiping their transactions amongst each other, the others will join eventually as well, and the block case creation will be started. Let's visualize that quickly. So first, we look at the case of synchronous consensus protocols, where you often have a fixed frequency of block creation, and what that means for latency. So if you would send a transaction at that point, you would at least have to wait until the next block has been finished. So the latency would be about that. And if no transaction comes, then you would also create empty blocks as well, of course. So with blocks which are created needlessly. Transaction delay, your latency would be in on average about half of the distance between the blocks. When you look at an asynchronous protocol, when there's no load, it will not create any blocks at all, which means when one transaction comes, it immediately starts to create a block. So the latency is just the length of the time it takes to create a block. It will not create any empty blocks either. And what that also means that when an asynchronous network is under constant load, it constantly creates blocks. This diagram actually is misleading. Each block could be of different length and will probably in the real world of the internet will be of different size. So this is not a fixed timer, like you might think. For looking at just at the diagram, this is just it finishes the block, and if there's something on the transaction queue, it will just create the next one, and it's designed to do that way. There is really not a break there, not an idle time where it waits for something to happen. If there's work, then it will work, so let's sum that up quickly. It's like having a block creation bursts. As Honeybadger BFT was designed to never take a break as long as there's work to do. There is no idle time if none is necessary. It produces new blocks as fast or as slow as the network allows. And therefore, it doesn't need rules to cope with network latency fluctuations like many other synchronous protocols. Because you might think, well, I mean, if I want to make that as efficient as an asynchronous protocol, why don't I make the block time so short that it will always create a block? But in reality, that's very problematic with most synchronous protocols. So for Honeybadger, to work, I mean, it has got some requirements. You need a direct connection between validators, for it to be high performance. In theory, you could go through many hops, but it does have a communication overhead. So for highest performance, direct connection is recommended. Then it does need full control over block creation, which is different from most other consensus protocols implemented in Ethereum clients today, which does cause some challenges when integrating it. Also, the selection of transactions is very different from other consensus algorithms. And of course, it uses threshold encryption, and this key generation needs to happen on chain, which is another complication. And you need block generation triggers. That's we talked about already. That's not really difficult to implement. When we look at communication cost, the cost is n squared times log n. So you wouldn't want to run it with a lot of validators, because your latencies will just explode at a certain point. There is some when you look at the diagram, you see the lines are straight in the beginning, which means the protocol itself has the overhead. It outweighs the actual payload, and when you have got more larger and larger batch sizes, then slowly the communication costs slowly rises. So it does favor throughput over latency. When you look at the latency, you see that when you've got just a like 32 or 40 validators, its latency is very very good, actually, in a very good space. But as soon as you add more and more, the latencies become enormous at a certain point. So it's really when you want to drive it with a larger group of validators, you have to use something like postal, like the postal contracts, which we will talk about later, where there is only a smaller set of validators active at any point, and in every epoch, when the validator set changes, it just selects randomly from the rest of the pool. So the most validators will become most potential validators will become validators at some point, active validators. And as said before, it even works in the Tor network. Of course, maybe not with the highest numbers of validators, but you see, you can even with 16 validators, you can still have a reasonable performance in one of the toughest environments for consensus algorithms there is. As you said, if you want to use Honey Badger with a large number of validators, you will need something like a postal contract. In practice, you will need to switch validator sets at some point. You can't just start with a fixed set of validators, and then for all eternity, that's it. You will want to add or remove validators. As usual, the time periods where the validator set stays constant are called epochs. That requires renegotiation of threshold encryption keys before the validator set is switched, which has to be done on-chain. So unlike in other consensus protocols like in Aura, you can't switch immediately. You have to have that negotiation. Then the validators need to monitor the chain or that contract in which these key negotiation messages are being sent, and switch to the new epoch and a validator set when the new keys can be generated. So when there's enough data sent from all the future validators from the pending validator set, then the current validator set switches over to the next set. Let's see, I created a little diagram to visualize that. So we've got an epoch here, epoch one, and then the next one. Within an epoch, the same value data set is valid. And when you start the chain, that means you have to write the key generation data into the chain spec, the chain spec. Then after a defined time, and that time will be defined in the contract, which switches over, which selects the new validator data set, the pending validators begin the key generation phase, while the active validators check if there's enough data to generate those keys. And when there's enough data, then they hand over the control to the next validator set, and the new epoch begins. Now this keygen data, as we said, has to be on chain. Let's see quickly how much memory we are talking about here. And here I measured it from 3 to 50 validators and summed up the size of all the messages that are necessary to be stored on chain. And there you see that at like 48 or something like that, you reach 20 megabytes of on-chain memory use. So that's also a factor where you have to weigh how many active validators you want on chain. Now this on-chain memory can be reused, so it wouldn't increase the state on the chain. So you want to delete it at the end of each epoch, or reuse it, or in some other way, so it doesn't pile up on the chain. Then the next thing is, now we want to use this great consensus protocol in practice. So how do we do that? There is an implementation called the HPVFT. It's a Rust crate implemented by Andreas Fackler from Apoor Network. That implementation is already very stable. There already has been one integration attempt into Open Ethereum, also from the side of Apoor Network, which used a separate Honey Badger BFT client called Hydro Badger, communicating with the Open Ethereum process. It ended up to be too complex to continue, so I got asked to take a look and come up with an integration approach that is a bit simpler than that. Since I already knew larger parts of the Open Ethereum code base, I suggested that we just solve the problem inside of the Open Ethereum code base, without external processes and message passing between them. Just reuse what Open Ethereum already offers. And one, of course, is the pluggable consensus engine. So build on that. Then direct peer-to-peer communication between validators. When you look into the source code, then of course all broadcasting is also done with direct connections. So at a low enough level, it is a connection between the node and other nodes. So you know exactly who that is, what his node ID is. All these things are actually known. Then you also want to keep the connection running. Yeah? For that, there is actually already a system in Open Ethereum called Reserved Peers. So we can build on that. It also has an internal API for it. Since Open Ethereum supports multiple consensus engines already, it also has got a sub protocol for sending consensus messages. So we build on that as well, instead of building a separate network with separate ports and everything on the side. One thing that Open Ethereum didn't do at that point was to provide the PID, which is necessary to associate a certain connection with a node and with a validator in that case uniquely. So that required some changes. Then, of course, a function to send messages using that PID, so you can target messages. So both on receiving, we need to know from which peer it comes, and on sending, we need to know to which peers we send to. Then we needed to add full control over block creation. Usually, the Open Ethereum code base just open a block and add it new transactions to it. And at a certain point, when the consensus engine was ready to create the block, it just took it and signed it. And that's just completely different from the way Honey Badger works. Honey Badger does everything up front. So it selects the transactions up front. And when it's ready to create the block, it already knows what's in it. So it has to have the full control of it. It will create the block, and at that point, it's already final. Then we needed to add a callback to notify engines about transaction queue imports, because we need to trigger it. There are no natural triggers. There are no timers which create blocks. So the engine itself has to take full control over that. And for that, it needs to know all the information necessary to make the decision to create a new block. And one of them is just to know that there are new transactions available. And when it knows that there are transactions available, it has to also be able to query those transactions to select from those. All these things were not available at the before our adaptations to the code. Then adapt consensus message sending in Honey Badger, it's also not good when consensus messages get lost. In the consensus engines which were used, which were implemented in Open Ethereum up to this point, that wasn't really such a big of a problem, which means they just got dropped. If two validators weren't connected, the messages were just dropped. That wouldn't work for Honey Badger. So we had to make modifications on sending of messages, so caching messages, and on reconnection, sending them out. Then, of course, we, instead of having an external process where the HPBFD was running, we had to integrate the HPB Rust trait and use it from inside of Open Ethereum. That required a couple of changes as well to make it compatible with all the dependencies, which, of course, both the HPBFD crate has and Open Ethereum already had. Okay, then came up with a little diagram to visualize what is actually happening here. Transactions will be imported into the validator, into the transaction queue. The transaction queue then notifies the engine, and that didn't exist before. That was something that we had to add. Then if it receives more than F, so the maximum number of 40 nodes which are allowed is identified by the variable F normally. So if there are more than F proposals from others, then you also have to trigger a new consensus epoch. And that's an unfortunate naming collision, because also in HPFD, each block is called an epoch as well. So that's not the epoch which we talked about before, where we had validator sets, where a stable validator data set defined one epoch. Here the epoch means HPBFT, one HPBFT consensus round. We would need another arrow from here back to here, because the proposals come in, of course, as consensus messages from other validators. But at that point, a a new consensus epoch is created. Either a new one is created or it joins an existing one. And then it starts sending out consensus messages. And this has to be direct. So we had to add a new function to send directed messages. And of course, when consensus messages are received from other validators, it also had to be slightly amended to give us the PID so we can know which validator we talk to. When the consensus is reached, and let's remember at this point, we already know which transactions will be included. So a new function had to be created. So we create a block with a predefined set of transactions. Then Open Ethereum requests from the HPBFT engine to seal the block, which it does, and then calls a function to finally seal and import the block. So that's the whole process on a high level, how the consensus and the block generation works in Open Ethereum. We implemented it and it worked. Yeah, it worked, which is not often that when you have a plan that hardly had to change anything of the approaches. The list of things that we thought we had to do in the beginning were pretty much the ones which we actually had to do, and then it worked. We started a test network, HPBFT1 test network. We currently get around 400-450 transactions per second. That is before having attempted to optimize it. I see a couple of ways to get to higher transaction rates. But what's very encouraging is that it's extremely stable. We had that network running for the last 3 weeks. It was under heavy load, and not even once it had any crashes or any had to restart any of the nodes. So it's already extremely stable for the state it is currently. The latencies are also great. So we see 350 milliseconds that's measured from a JavaScript to a Node.js process. From the time the transaction was sent and from the time it received the confirmation that it's actually on the chain. And let's remember that this means it's install finalized with Honeybadger. That means you don't even have to wait any longer. As soon as you get the confirmation, it's you can be sure that that's on the chain and that stays the state. But with other consensus engines, you often have to wait a couple of blocks to be reasonably sure that this will be what's final on the chain. So that's a really good number as well. So what's up to do next? We of course want to get the performance even higher. The integration with post-hour contracts is on the way with the help of some other, which we will mention afterwards. Then persisting current epoch consensus messages on shutdown is something that I think will be very important to do before calling it production ready. Currently messages are, as we said before, cached when the connection with other validators is not established. But actually, the state in which the HPBFT engine is in should be preserved as well. So there can be cases, for example, when there's a client binary update, you may have multiple people stopping their client and at the same time and starting them at the same time, and that could cause the chain to get into a state where two-thirds of the validators are not available, which it needs to make blocks. That in itself is not a problem as long as they start again. But if they start up again, they will be in a clean state. So they will not be restored to the state they were when they were shut down. And that might be a problem. It's not something that will stall the chain forever, but you might have to ask the node operators to shut down the nodes and start them up again to get out of that situation. And this is something that we want to avoid, and it can be avoided by persisting the current epoch consensus messages on a regular shutdown. So that's, I consider, something important for production readiness. And of course, we want to do more testing, especially more unit testing on the code. Now, that was a cooperation which involved a lot of different organizations, and I want to say thanks to those who contributed. One was Lab10, especially Thomas Sensinger and Dietmar Hofer, who are the mastermind behind the Artist Network. I want to give a special shout out to Thomas Haller, who really worked hard last week to get the Web3 tests working which is not simple in Ethereum networks. Then I want to thank Igor and Andreas Fackler. Of course, Andreas Fackler being the mastermind behind the HPPFT crate and the protocol implementation. Then I want to thank Fabian Vogelstaller and Janis Stammelakos, I hope I pronounced it right, who are working on the PostDAO integration with HPPFT right now. And I want to thank Helmut Siedl from DMD, who provided the testing infrastructure to us. And of course, Open Ethereum and Parity for providing us with a base which we can build on. Finally, I want to plug the Rust user group community, which I founded 2 years ago. So the next meeting will still be online because of the coronavirus. So everybody is invited to join. And yeah, with that, we can enter the questions.
Thank you so much, David. Appreciate all the effort that went into that. Mm-hmm. If anybody has questions, you can feel free to jump ahead or raise your hand. I'll look in the chat for any text questions. You blew their minds, David.
Yeah, it was a bit too technical at some point. But this is actually the more higher level one. There is a talk I gave like a year ago for the blockchain hub in Graz, which is going more the detail of the protocol itself. Here it was more about what can it do, what are the properties of it, and what are the advantages of it in production operation.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Thank you, David. Mm-hmm. I was just thinking, so it's censorship resistant. I was thinking, what are the implications on front running? So how exactly does the algorithm for transaction ordering work?
Transaction ordering, I mean, as I said, what's suggested in the paper is that you randomly select transactions from the maximum size of transactions that you expect to be able to include in a block.
Okay, but if I'm a malicious validator, I mean malicious not in the sense that I violate the protocol, but that I don't follow that recommendation. Mm-hmm. Let's say I add my own transaction, which I want to front run another one. Mm-hmm. So can I mess with the probability such that my transaction gets included first, or could that be prevented or mitigated in this protocol?
I mean, I mean, if you're a validator that then gets included in the block and the transaction is valid, then it will be in. Yeah.
But what about the order? What if I specifically want to get in front of another transaction which is in the pool? Mm-hmm. Can I achieve that by creating the transaction such that the hash is somehow smaller than the other or?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean in the end the transactions which are in the block need to be exactly the same on every block, yeah, which means the ordering needs to be also be the same for every block, which means the order in which the contributions will end up in the block is determined by the order in which the validator set is defined, actually.
Aha, so it means that the validator, which is first in the list in this epoch, basically has the power for front running, but only that one.
Yeah.
Like this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, of course, as an implementer, you can implement any scheme, but that would be one of the most obvious ones. To assure that the order of the transaction is exactly the same for all blocks, for all validators.